Here is our flowchart for a for loop. A for loop, honestly, it has an odd flow of execution. So we'll look at the flowchart first, and then we'll look at the code, and I'm going to write it in a very particular way to help us understand it. But what makes it a little bit more complicated than a while loop is three of the parts of any looping structure, the initialization, the condition, and the updating of that condition, all occur within the for loop itself, like within the parentheses itself. That said, the flowchart is still kind of similar. We do the initialization first and only once. We then evaluate the condition. If it's true, we execute the body of the loop. That's where the statement is. It says increment here, but we somehow change a variable or a state that will affect our condition. And then we reevaluate that condition. It's just how syntactically we put these parts in is a little bit different for the for loop. So let's take a look at that together. So we're going to add another example here, public static void for example. And we're going to count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 again. We're going to do the same code as before, but now we're going to do it with a for loop. So first we'll describe the for loop. For loop. There are three parts of the for loop statement. Okay. So the while loop just has a condition in the parentheses. The for statement has three separate parts all within the same pair of parentheses. Here they are. First is the initialization, and that is executed once. Second is the condition, and that is the Boolean expression, just like the while loop. That part's just like the while loop. It is evaluated at the start of each iteration. And then third, and this is where I think the confusion comes from, this is where we update the loop variable. It's part of the for loop statement itself, but it is executed at the end of each iteration. However, it is executed before evaluating the condition again. I think it's hard to understand that with the words, but I think when we see it and we're going to step through it in the debugger together here in just a moment, it makes a lot more sense. So here's how the syntax is written. I'm going to write each of these three parts on a separate line of code in BlueJay. I'm doing that very intentionally because that way when we debug it, it's going to be clear which part of the for statement is executed. You will often see a for statement written on a single line of code, which is fine once we get comfortable with it. But for now, I'm going to do it as three separate lines of code. So the first line of code is going to be the initialization. So I have for, I open the parentheses, I say int count equals one. That is the initialization. Kind of like we did with the while loop, except now it's inside of the for statement. On my next line of code, I'm going to say count is less than or equal to 5. That's the condition. And other than being the second thing separated by semicolons within the for statement, that's a lot like the while. And then the third part is on my third line of code, and I say count plus plus. And this is where we update the loop variable. And then we have the curly brackets. And inside of which we can say system.out.println count. And that is the body. So we still have the same four parts that we did with the while loop. They're just in a different order when we type the code. But as we're going to see when we step through the code in a moment, they're executed in the same order as they were with the while loop. So if you're looking at this for statement and being like, this looks nothing like the for statement I learned in Python, you are correct, okay? It is totally different. This for statement comes from C in terms of the syntax, like most of the confusing things we run into. The Python for statement is super useful, and Java has a version like that. It's just not this one. Next unit, we'll learn about a different type of for loop that is very similar to the Java or to the Python's like for each loop that you use with like lists and things. So we're going to see that in the next unit. It does exist in Java. This just isn't it. So. I'm going to set a breakpoint by clicking in the white column right here and getting my little stop sign. I'm going to do it right here in the first line of code because I want to step through this together and really highlight the flow of execution because that's the most confusing part of this. So I'm going to put the code on the left screen and the debugger on the right screen. And the line of code that's highlighted in green is the line of code that is about to be executed. So we're about to do the initialization part. We're about to initialize the variable count to one. Right now we have no local variables because we haven't done that yet. Once I hit step, the line of code highlighted in green will execute. Count will have a value of one. And now we can see right away that the next line of code that is being evaluated is the condition. Count is less than or equal to five. So if count is less than or equal to five, if one is less than or equal to five, it is, that's true. We are not going to increment count. We're going to jump to the body of the for loop and run and do that print statement again. So you're going to see that as I hit step, we skip over the increment and we're going to execute the system out println instead. This will print the value of one to the terminal. And then it will, what the line of code that's executed next is the increment, right? So now we're back to the for statement and we're in the third part of it where we're going to increment count by one. When we do that, count's going to become two. And the next line of code that's going to execute is the condition. We're going to check is count less than or equal to five. It is, it's true. We're going to run the body again. But just note that after we finish with the body of the for loop, the next line of code that runs is the third part of that for statement. And then after that executes, then we go and check the second part of the for statement, which is the condition, to decide if the loop keeps running or not. So the flow of execution is a little strange until we get used to it. Okay. So that's why I like stepping through it in the debugger, and that's why I think it's helpful to write it on three separate lines of code for now, as we're using the debugger as well. The syntax is quite a bit different, but it is a lot like for x in range 1 dot dot 5, right? Yeah. Let's add one more statement here. Let's do system.out.println. Let's print the final value of count. Great questions. So the question was, does count exist outside of the for loop? And apparently the answer is no, because the Java compiler is saying that the variable count is undeclared. Even though we declare count here and it's outside of these parentheses, it is still scoped to the entire for statement itself. So we can't use count, which is declared here, anywhere outside of this for statement. Okay. I know that can be a little confusing because you're like, wait a minute, this isn't within these brackets. Why is it limited to those brackets? Because this is all considered like one block on its own. All right, so let's make a note about this so we aren't surprised when we run into it later. variables declared. By declared, again, I mean you specify the type and the variable name for the first time. Variables declared within the for statement are scoped to the for statement and its body. So we got to comment this out. This isn't going to work. That said, it is quite reasonable to want to access a variable that we might use within that for statement outside of the for statement. So let's actually copy everything from the for statement through here. And let's make a second method where we can see how we can do that. So public static void, for example, 2. I'll paste that code in, get rid of the comment. So the way we refactor this for this to work is we want to change as little as possible. We still want to have the initialization within the for statement. We simply need to declare the variable count before the for statement, and then we can just refer to it without redeclaring it. We'll just use the variable count and initialize it here. So that's the only change we have to make this actually work. So just keep that in mind. If you do need the variable after the for statement, just declare it first. Often we don't, but sometimes we do. All right, let's look at an example of tracing.